So greetings to all the viewers. Welcome to the session organized by Tilotama Foundation titled Role of India in Post-Pandemic World Order with Special Focus on USA and China. Tilotama Foundation has been organizing virtual discussions with experts from all around the world on issues of international and national significance. Today's speaker is Dr. Manav Dwivedi. Manav Dwivedi, author and professor, Indian Institute of Public Administration. His book, Into Internal Security Threats to Social Asia, 2013, International Relations Theory, A Theoretician Insight into a Novian Discipline, 2010, and South Asia Security, 2008. I am Devushmita Nondi, Executive Public Relations and HR at Tilotama Foundation. In the post-pandemic situation, India is poised to play a major role globally. India presently holds the chair of the executive board of the World Health Organization. India has also been elected as non-permanent member of the United Nations Security Council for the term 2021 to 2022 with a great majority. India's relation with the United States and China will have a special impact on how the international politics play out. I request Dr. Dwivedi to begin his talk.
All right, thanks a lot. First of all, I would like to express my heartfelt thankfulness to the Tilotama Foundation for having contacted me. In a swirl of a moment, when I was contacted on the Facebook page itself, and I thought it would be a very pertinent instrument through which one can go ahead with encapsulating about the international system. When we talk about the international system, then what we need to realize is that there has been an epochal division. There has been a change which has been attempted. There has been a phase-wise change which has been attempted by international relations scholars, observers, and also by the students of world politics. Now, if you look into it, there have been certain landmarks which have been reached in the international system, in the larger international system. The first one being the Cold War. That is the division of the world into the capitalist bloc and the socialist bloc, led by United States of America at one side of the fence and Soviet Union at the other side of the fence. It saw a lot of dominoes coming up. It led to the upsurge of the containment strategy by the grandiloquent American dream strategy. So that all these can lead to one offense of United States of America. Then we can directly jump on to the year 1989 and 1991, wherein the Cold War ended. Soviet Union faced a period of dismemberment. And after that, it was the general breakdown of the Berlin Wall and the initiation of the New World Order, which was reflected by President George Bush and his Operation Desert Storm, getting the better of Saddam Hussein in the Mesopotamian base of Iraq. So, you know, that kind of a thing continued. In 1999, we had the Asian bubble, where the tiger economies of the order of Vietnam, of the order of Philippines, and other nations such as Indonesia, Japan, South Korea, they faced an economic downturn. Then came the 2001 September 11 catastrophe, which brought the Americans out of their cocoon. And these were the changing and transformative phases. Such particularistic time periods, wherein we could actually go ahead and look into a change in the international structure of nation states, a change in the international institutions, and a gradual transformation in the behavior of the various countries. Then came, we can easily move on to another epoch or another transformative event, wherein we can look into the year 2008 with the property bubble burst and the Lehman crisis which occurred. And then we had the coming in of Prime Minister Narendra Modi in 2014, in May 2014. So, you know, these are various phases and epochs which have led to a change or transformation or a kind of a gradual metamorphosis of the larger international system. Now we have another change which is staring at us right in our faces. That is the COVID, the Wuhan virus or the China virus. And why the Americans and the Chinese have once again become the talk of the town is that in the context of the current problem, the current border scuffle going on between Indian Union and the People's Republic of China, we need to be very sure about what the People's Republic of China wants from India. Now, if you look into the general idea of the post-COVID world order, then we can easily fathom out a possibility or two. Twin-pronged analysis can be put forward and advanced before the people or before the audience. I would like to enumerate the first as being a commoner's pet peeve. Now, under the fulcrum of this commoner's pet peeve, one can look into the idea of the receding away of globalization, convergence, and complex interdependence, wherein the nations have started looking inwards. The first example is President Donald Trump's United States of America and the grandiloquent interventionist American dream, which the Americans have lived since the era of Vietnam, since the era of the Vietnam War, going all the way down to Afghanistan, Iraq, and then finally Syria. So the idea is that America also, President Trump also, has actually succumbed before the international pandemic, that is COVID, Wuhan virus or China virus, which he has lovingly named it, placing the entire blame of the world disorder at the footsteps and at the doorsteps of the Han, H-A-N, Han, that is the People's Republic of China. What they have done is that all across the world, I personally feel the countries are going to look inwards. Protectionism, nationalism, devoid of the words xenophobia, devoid of the words of nomenclature of the order of Zingoism. The countries are going back into their own shells. They are going into their own shells wherein the patriotic instincts are going to rule the roost as far as the geopolitics, geostrategy, and geoeconomics of the larger international system is concerned. That is the market-oriented approach at a global level, which was earlier festooned on to the metrics of the international economic system, is going to go for a grand MS Dhoni type six. And the countries are going to rely upon Atmanirbharta, that is self-reliance. Recently, Prime Minister Modi also talked about it, wherein he gave the slogan of local is global and global is local. And he said that Atmanirbharta or self-reliance should be the order of the day for the Indians. But what we should realize is that this dream should be assiduously adhered to and followed by the Indian Union, by New Delhi, but it will take a decade. It might take another two terms from Prime Minister Modi to come to terms to really bring out such changes in the international system in India. Now, India has a great opportunity. Now, India has a great opportunity in the sense that India can really enter into this new fabric of EPN, that is the new network of nations, the new economic productive network, which has been propounded and initiated by Michael Pompeo, who is the Secretary of State of United States of America. He has talked about bringing back the Quad approach. The Quad approach being that India, Japan, Australia, and the grandiloquent might at the city on the Mount Sinai, the nation on the Mount Sinai, that is United States of America, all four of them are going to be the driving actors as far as the larger geopolitical and geoeconomical metrics of Asia or the Orient is concerned. There is going to be in the post-COVID order, along with the fall of grace, fall from grace of globalization and convergence, these new nations will definitely form a phalanx of alliances, a phalanx of coalitions against China, against the doughty, but a very much vitriolic and vicious People's Republic of China. Now, we are not talking only in the terms of politics, but if we look into the economics part of it also, then what we are going to realize is that Ruchir Sharma, in his book, The Breakdown of Nations, has beautifully come forward with this particular idea, with this specific idea, wherein he explains thematically and very picturously the islands of prosperity which were connected by maglevs, that is magnetic levitation. Now these are these super fast trains which seem to fly past people in a whiz, and they are the ones which are the symbolic elements. They are the symbols of the rising power, clout, influence, and the prosperity and the great power status for which the People's Republic of China aspires for. The maglevs move one inch above the tracks, and that is supposed to be the kind of novelty, the nouveau nature of technology, power, and speed, which has become synonymous with People's Republic of China. And if you look at United States of America, if I quote from Milton Friedman's book, World is Flat, then it so occurs that Milton Friedman's nephew is coming to meet him from New York, and Milton Friedman has a house in Bethesda in United States of America. He goes in there and he meets the people, and when he alights from the train platform, then he is encountered by a faulty accelerator, and the slick edges of rotted glass, the slick edges of shining aluminium and iron are no longer present in the Bethesda train platform, metro platform, or whatever you call it, the railway platform. And this happens to come as a, this comes as a surprise to him, or this has been very well postulated by Milton Friedman when he meets his nephew, and the nephew relates the entire incident, or the entire deterioration, or a dysfunction in the transport infrastructure and the investment and the sheen mechanism for which United States of America is known for. Have the edges of development and the sheen been blunted for United States of America, or does People's Republic of China, has it done better and in a much more advanced manner for its own people and the rest of the world? These are the questions that we are going to deal with. And these questions are going to become the paramount pointers. These questions will become the important signifiers. They will become the important signifiers as far as the idea of hegemony and expansiveness is concerned. Now, People's Republic of China actually deals with the idea of hegemony and expansiveness, wherein land grab and territoriality seem to be part of the Chinese foreign policy and the attendant national interest. It is this hegemonic and arm-twisting policy which will become the key defining element of China in the post-COVID order. And as we were talking about Michael Pompeo and his Quad and his economic political network, all the countries are going to come together under the umbrella of the Indian Union and United States of America, where they are going to militate and attempt, they will attempt hard to contain the People's Republic of China. Because if we see it right now, the world, both the nations, the Indian Union and the People's Republic of China, are suffering for each other. And India is suffering because of the incursions which China has undertaken since the last 2 to 3 decades. Whether it be the Sub Norong Chu incident in the late 80s, whether it be the Doklam standoff in 2017, or whether it be the Daulat Beg Oldie logjam in 2013-14, things have not gone on well. In 2012, a particular treaty was signed with New Delhi being one party to it and Beijing being the other party to it, wherein the accidental overtures or the intentional overtures and maneuvers made by People's Republic of China's patrols and the Indian patrols into Chinese territory and the Chinese patrols inside the Indian territory, they became the bone of contention. So it was decided very firmly and very steadfastly in 2012 itself. It's a treaty wherein the countries promised to each other as part of a legal document that if such kind of a surpassing of the LOAC or the line of actual control takes place, whether it be in the western sector or the eastern sector, then both the countries, the patrols are not going to fire upon each other. There would be no Atishbaji, as the protagonist in Paltan, the movie, the Bollywood movie construct says. So the general idea being this particular notion, that India has to look into this perennial problem, this perennial pain in the backbone, wherein China always acts in an expansive manner as a territorial dada, as a territorial don, and as a hegemon. Gone are the days when United States of America could be curtailed or could be nomenclatured as a neo-colonialistic, neo-liberal, and as a kind of a rich man's country. China is too following the footsteps of United States of America. If we see its latest military moves and its latest diplomatic maneuvers. Now, it is United States and India which will have to mull over their strategies and foreign policies in the post-COVID order, where they will have to rethink their policies, they will have to realign their policies with each other, and they will have to indulge in a throwback to 2000 and to 2010, when the People's Republic of China became a part of the World Trade Organization and other such organizations. And one should realize that nationalism, territoriality, and individual mulling over one's foreign policy is going to become the order of the day as far as the post-COVID international order is concerned. This is going to be one part wherein India, China, Australia and Japan need to come together, and whether it be the arguments in or against the favor of RCEP, that is the Regional Comprehensive Economic Union Partnership, or TPP, that is the Trans-Pacific Partnership, whether the Asiatic space, whether the Orient wants a leadership of China or wants to koto along with the policies of United States of America. These issues will be once again become pertinent in the post-COVID order. New transformations, new changes are going to come. But at the present moment, at the present strategic cusp, we need to look at where the conflicts between India and China can simmer or snowball into a full-fledged military conflict. Gone is the day of man-to-man combat when soldiers used to fight in the border areas. Some limited sorties from the enemy countries would fly over Jodhpur from Pakistan. They would fly over Jaipur, they would fly over Lahore and Amritsar, and they would be followed by our daredevil fighters, the Top Gun variants in the Indian Air Force. And finally, our soldiers on the ground would normally get the better of their Pakistani counterparts. But we have the intercontinental ballistic missiles now. The advancement in technology, communication, and the command and control mechanisms have made war a very different and a difficult proposition. If a war breaks out, then the IOARC region, the Bay of Bengal, the Malacca Straits, and the Indian Ocean, the Bay of Bengal, all this oceanic territory is going to be impacted by the churning that would go on as a result of a conflict or a maritime conflict between New Delhi and between Beijing. This is one part of it. Kashmir might come in the play. The western sector, Arunachal Pradesh, Sikkim, and the all-pervading question of chicken neck, that would also come into play. So, you know, what China has done, according to the allegation, according to the steadfast allegation of not only America and India, because that would make them appear partisan, bipartisan, in a bipartisan manner. The European nations and the rest of the countries have gone on to contend that why did the virus originate from China? Is it a construct of bioterror apparatus which has been working in China in its Wuhan lab and have, or it is only the eating habits of eating alive live snakes that is going to have some kind of an impact into the development of this virus? And if you look at the general intelligence theater also, we are going to find that bioterrorism, chemical terrorism, they have always been initiated by China, and maybe something happened in Italy, maybe something happened in Iran in the early days of COVID, wherein from the European steppes, from the European mountains, from the Alps, this thing has gone down to, this thing has traveled all the way to India and to South Asia. So the general idea in the post-COVID order is going to be a clash. And what we should pray in a God-forbidding manner is that a new world war, a World War III, should not develop, because that is very costly, very expensive, which will cause a tremendous amount of collateral damage to innocent populations. But we also need to look at the other aggressive, at the nationalistic posture, without being jingoistic and without acting as warmongers. That enough is enough. Since the last three decades, India has been armed to its teeth. India has been bullied. Well, that is the reality. That is the reality of the border in Pangong, Hot Springs, Aksai Chin. I'm taking, if you draw a line, then the present conflict brings into relief the regions of Pangong. Going upwards, we reach the Hot Springs area. Then further, going further upwards, we reach the Galwan Valley, where the battle lines have been already drawn and Chinese have lost 60 soldiers. India has seen 20 of its soldiers getting martyred along with Colonel Babu. That is, along with Colonel Babu. And if we go up, we reach the Chinese administered Aksai Chin. Then we go on to reach the Gilgit and Baltistan, whose maps were very cannily, very cleverly, and very steadfastly printed by India as part of its one of its climate news programs in Jammu and Kashmir, which has raised the ire in the Chinese power circles and Chinese military. So, you know, this is a very curious amalgamation. This happens to be a curious geostrategic and geoeconomic mix, which is going to hold sway in the post-pandemic COVID order, in the post-COVID world order, wherein the other countries such as India, America, New Zealand, Australia, Japan, South Korea, they have to come together. And also, why do we leave out the Europeans? Why do we leave out the South Americans and the Latin Americans? Where the rise of a new hegemon has to be contained. And with President Trump, despite his whimsical, idiosyncratic, and very unpredictable Twitter diplomacy, there is a void conclave between India and United States of America. So another element of which is worth take noting will be the rising detente between Washington and New Delhi. President Trump might be unpredictable. President Trump might be unreliable to a great extent. Who else can tell it, other than the German Chancellor Angela Merkel, who's known to make faces and statements at whatever President Donald Trump does. But still, carrying on in the same connection, what we need to underline over here is that India and United States of America are going to be the key players of the international system, wherein both the countries, as liberal democracies, as the upholders of the liberal order, as the upholders of constitutionalism, and as the embodiments of rule of law, they have a lot of convergence, a lot of commonality, thus resulting in this kind of a cooperative exchanges, cooperative competitiveness, and cooperative bilaterals, which have become the order of the day, which is once again a chief characteristic of the India and America detente. Gone are the days when an author in his novel in his novel The Inscrutable Americans, would say that a typical Indian student in America would come from a small town in Madhya Pradesh, that is Jajua. He would come from a small town in Madhya Pradesh, Jajua, and he would be known for his oily hair, which would be dripping with oil onto the coveralls of his white and blue shirt, or a tequila colored shirt. And then he would talk endlessly on and on, go on about the tales of his father's oil manufacturing factory in Jajua. And alongside that, he would strive to get an engineering degree for himself so that he can get skillfully welded and own or once again run his father's oil shack in the Madhya Pradesh town of Jajua. So, you know, that kind of a stereotypically cow, fly and sadhu and serpent imagery, which was festooned onto India by people like Mark Twain, that is no longer the linchpins or the defining elements of the international system. In fact, as I was telling earlier on, I would like to end it here, that India and United States of America are going to team up with Israel. And there was a poster which myself, as a student of Jawaharlal Nehru University, in the building, in the premises of School of International Studies, we painted three tanks. One tank, I don't remember the makes or the models of the battle tanks right now, but all the three tanks belonging to India, United States and Israel were there. All three of them were painted as a poster by me and my collage and poster making team, and it was stuck up onto the water cooler of SIS, as during those times things were technologically and challenged in SIS, and one could only have one cooler. So that over the water cooler, we placed that thing there, and to my surprise, that occurred in 2004. During my every visit to SIS, I still find traces, half of it still remaining there at the water cooler, along with the posters of other political student outfits in the confines of SIS, in the confines of JNU. So I would myself predict, I am no Nostradamus, I am no forecaster or some kind of an astrologer, but still India, Israel, United States of America, Australia, Japan, South Korea, and a few countries here and there, they are going to define the new post-COVID world order, and which all would have the aim to contain the hegemonistic, debilitating and nihilistic foreign policy machinations of People's Republic of China. Apart from this, if you look into the model, the Chinese economic model is not there for the long term. Because if you look into it, what we are going to find is that it is not supportive of its own customer market. They don't let the other countries to invest and do open business in China, though their own firms, their own brands have nearly made a killing in the Indian markets and also in the markets in United States of America. If you look into the Chinese thing, in the context of China, we can quote a study which has been brought out by Adam Przewoski, who is teaching in the University of Chicago and the University of New York. He has said that we cannot directly say that democracies are not going to grow fast, and the autocracies and the authoritarian states are going to grow much faster. He has taken in his report, Professor Adams has talked about countries like Kazakhstan and Myanmar, which actually have registered growth rates of 10% in the last 5 to 10 years, despite dabbling into democracy and autocracy. South Korea, also between the time period of 1950 and 1990, it went on, and it was under an autocratic rule. It was under the suzerainty of a dictator, but it became an East Asian miracle. Countries like Portugal, Greece, Portugal, Greece, and Thailand, they were democracies and they did very well. And so what we can say is that just because China is an autocratic state or authoritarian state ruled by the Communist Party, that actually does not mean that countries need to be strict in their own domestic spheres and their domestic denominations, or they need to be authoritarian if the miracle of China needs to be replicated, because it is not very much sustainable. It is not at all very much long-termish. So the idea I would like to end here, that the post-COVID world order will make the countries more nationalistic, more inward-looking. It would make them more less. It would make them less adventuristic as far as geoeconomics are concerned. And international institutions are going to take somewhat of a beating. And unless and until new countries like India find a permanent space in the United Nations Security Council, wherein India is ably supported by US and very vitriolically opposed by China, unless these changes take place, it is going to be a throwback to a system of dystopia. Who doesn't remember the flick Mad Max starring Mel Gibson, wherein a post-nuclear world is envisaged in the narrative of this cinematic construct? We look at the general idea wherein is wherein Mel Gibson's the Mad Max wife and kids have been killed by a marauders who are the oil dealers, who are the traders, and the general crooks in the Australian and American landscape have turned into killers. They have turned into looters. The manner in which he avenges the decimation of his family and the way he survives should not be the future characteristic or a future element espousing the future world order or the COVID world order. Thus, we would say that war is no solution, but China has to be dealt with, and a conclave which India can have with US. And if US agrees, and when US agrees to the India's overtures as a Vishwa Guru, as a nation dictating the terms of the entire world system, then there can be nothing better than this. Thanks a lot. These are a few enumerations, unstructured arguments and unstructured litany of thoughts which I can dole out to you as far as the present interaction is concerned. Thanks a lot for having me here.
Thank you, Dr. Dwivedi, for your very interesting presentation. There were a number of important ideas that are extremely relevant in the present scenario. India's role will always be a crucial one in the upcoming world order. India needs to be a resilient and determined in the execution of its foreign policy.
If there are any questions, I can answer or whatever.
I do have two questions. So, sir, do you think, doesn't China being a hegemon in Asia naturally call for a strong response from India? Should not India naturally try to counter China's move? It would be an act of balancing of power.
Very true. I personally feel that the way surgical strikes were undertaken by India over the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. We are not talking about a religion here. We are talking about a country which is a failed state. We are talking in terms of countries. We are not talking in terms of religion. So the idea is that Prime Minister Modi also said and declared after the Balakot strikes and after Pulwama had occurred, after the Pulwama massacre, that we are not going to be a soft state anymore. India will get into the territory of the enemy, and finally it occurred when the Balakot terror camps were annihilated, they were destroyed, and that received a lot of support in the public opinion in India and the general collectivity of citizenry in India. Now, I personally feel, not in my personal opinion and not in an opinion as an academic on international relations, enough is enough as far as China is concerned. What rails me, what troubles me, and what concerns me, no bounds, happens to be the general idea. It happens to be the general idea that China has been intruding inside the LOC since the last two or three decades. And that has to be stopped somewhere. stopgap solutions, treaties such as 2012, talks between lieutenant generals and generals of both the countries, talks between the Chinese and the Indian ambassadors have taken place, but still China happens to be acting as a two-faced serpent. Now, when you are a serpent, we are a tiger, you are a dragon, we are a tiger. In such an animalistic and retrograde scenario, India has to be formed. And I personally feel war is a very difficult entity to declare. But I personally feel that despite the COVID times in India, where the Indian economy is in for a great time period of duress, and apart from the duress, the entire Indian political and health system is really shaking up. Even the Americans are passing through the same phase. But it is the Chinese tendency to really trouble India when India is already in a health kind of a soup. So India should at least remove the, remove the Chinese constructions, the Chinese roads, the Chinese encampments, which are there in Lipu Lake, which are there in Laptal, and which have come up in the last 10 odd years. And what is really surprising is that India has to take a step somewhere. India has to move inside the Chinese territory, because there was this beautiful road which has been constructed from the baser hinterland of Indian Himalayas to Lipu Lake, which is a 72 kilometer road, and which was built after a lot of risks and after a lot of casualties were faced by the BRO, that is the Border Road Organization. So when we make a road, they create a lot of chant about it. They call India as a conquistador and as an intruder. But when they prepare a road, when they build a bridge in the same area, which happens to be inside the Indian territory, then we can only make a face at themselves, or we can only skirm, square my number seats. So this kind of a left-sidical approach is not expected out of Prime Minister Modi, and India has to act, and these through an aerial warfare or through any other military mechanism, the Chinese encampments have to be vacated. That is my personal opinion as a non-academic, as being a citizen of this beleaguered nation. That is how I would respond to it. Despite COVID, despite so much of debilitation and human misery that surmounts all of us, you people there in Kolkata, myself in Delhi, people in colleges and universities, we are all facing it. We have turned into zombies where we don't even know whether our neighbor is a carrier of COVID or not. But in such a scenario, if the national territory, sovereignty, interdependence, and independence, and the boundaries are trifled with, then no option should remain before the New Delhi denomination but to contain the Chinese with at least a localized conflict or a skirmish, because Chinese need an answer. They are testing Indian patience. Well, all right. So I was talking about the India-China conflict. So in the post-COVID order, I personally prognosticate, as a citizen of this country, as a denizen of this proud nation, that China has to be countered. China has to be punched back. If the right message has to be given to the Chinese government, that India, this is not the India of 1962. This is the India of 1967, as was envisaged and reflected and picturized in J.P. Datta's flick Palter, wherein the Chinese come as part of the narrative of that movie, that flick. They come down to the Indian territory and try to dig some trenches and try to fix up certain barbed wires and barbed fences. At that point of time, the Indian commander, the main protagonist, the hero of Palter, comes down with his men and tells to the Chinese commander, ki agar aap logon ne ye band nahi kiya, to aaj wo ho jayega jo pehle kabhi nahi hua. So you know, that kind of a thing might sound emotional or rhetoric or verbiage, but that is how conflict, that is the nature of conflict which the Indian forces, which the ITBP and which 12 Bihar right now have been seeing since the last many years. So I would say that a sterner response and some kind of a limited strike needs to be carried on against China so that they can be taught a lesson of repeatedly and perennially and continuously, infringing upon India's territoriality. That would be my response to the moderator's question.
Sir, you talked about India's ICBMs. In a missile welfare scenario, do you think India has any strategic advantage over China, given its missiles have supposedly longer range?
Definitely. So you are conveying to me that China has a longer range or India has a longer range? Can I once again have the question, please?
So China has longer range.
That's what. China has a longer range, and I completely agree with you that the days of man-to-man combat are very much over. But still, bravado, patriotism, and the daredevilry of the Indian soldiers, as has been depicted in the battle stations in Hajipir, Longewala, and the battle which was depicted in Kesari, these things still very well play a role. Personal valor, personal sacrifice, and the supermanish like qualities which can be gathered by soldiers, which can be displayed by their commanders, still has a place. And it is not only a part of a myth, lore, legend, a story, or a patriotic humbug, as some people call. But this is how wars are fought. This is how countries win. I personally feel that Delhi might not be far off from Ghatiapgarh, from Pithoragarh, and from other regions, and a few other regions where the Chinese border meets India's border, and where the Galwan Valley crisis is taking place right now or unfolding before us. Yes, I very well agree with you. It might turn out to be a mad scenario. By mad, we mean mutually assured destruction. Chinese might not directly nuke us, but what is going to really happen is that they can fire an ICBM at us, or they can fire ICBMs at us all the way from Tibet or somewhere from Xinjiang or from near the borders, and it might land up in Delhi. It might land up in Kolkata. It might land up in Patna, or it might land up in the border towns in Uttarakhand. But that risk needs to be taken. We also have our BrahMos. We have our requisite weaponry of the order of Sagarika, and several other Agni we have, which have a large range. So we might be 19 to 20 in comparison to the Chinese ICBM. But I don't think that is the sole reason which can prevent India from giving a bloody nose to China. That is my opinion as a citizen and as a free-dealing spirit in this democratic country. There I feel for my country, and I can no longer tolerate the kind of maiming and lynching of Indian soldiers, 20 of them, took place at Galwan Valley. That would be my humble submission.
Sir, what role, if any, do you think North Korea would play in an Indian-China conflict if USA, Japan and others join in India's favor?
I personally feel that North Korea has no role to play as far as the Sino-India conflict is concerned. Because North Korea is itself a failed state, a debilitated country wherein nothing is free. It is completely dependent upon the dole outs of China and the limited trade which it carries on with a few countries in Asia Pacific and South Korea. I personally pray for peace in North Korea, despite what Kim Jong-un has been doing in the last couple of years, very much in the lines of a typically unpredictable political leader. I would personally feel that North Korea has no role to play, and North Korea might or might not have their missiles, might not have the reach all the way to India. But still, what I personally feel is that North Korea is itself in a soup, and it is non-existent as far as the geostrategic conundrum between India and China is concerned. That would be my humble submission.
Sir, what do you think about India's bid to greater reformation of the United Nations Security Council?
I personally feel that it is India, if you go back in the timeline, India, what it did was that we supported China's entry into WTO, and India itself facilitated China's entry into United Nations organization, that is the UN. So, you know, we have our own non-aligned strain of foreign policy, the strain of strategic autonomy, and the dictum, the non-aligned dictum of non-entanglement with the power blocks of the world, which have landed up India in a soup. And I personally feel that with so many formulas doing the rounds since 1965 is a landmark year where UNSC came out with a 9+, countries came out with a 9+4 formula. Countries like Canada, Australia, Germany, Japan, they were part of these deliberations, and India staked its repeated claims to become part and parcel of the United Nations Security Council. But the gleeful fact is that United States of America supports us now, Germany too supports us now, and I think Germany too is a contender. So, you know, despite all these glitches and the kind of important role that India has played or it is destined to play in a post-COVID world order, India rightfully deserves a place as a permanent member of the UNSC. That would be my brief remark.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sir, I also have one more question. So,
please go ahead.
Can you please clarify as to why you use the term detained, a Cold War era term? I'm fascinated about this word used by you. If you would kindly explain it, sir.
Definitely. What I would like to convey here is Cold War used to go on. But Cold War was actually a Cold War wherein no bullets were fired, no missiles were not thrown at each other, though they were targeted. So it was a kind of the world. The world was in a kind of, was at a position of a precipice. The world was at the end of a cliff where anything could have happened. Vietnam was an exception where America took a grand beating, and which led to a lot of, rethinking and delving inside by the strategic and defense structure in the United States of America. Cuban missile crisis was an incident which we all know about. Cuban missile crisis was an excellent example of how the functioning of the Cold War or the running of the Cold War took place, wherein the Americans were asked to remove the Jupiter missiles from Turkey, which were targeted at Russia, at Soviet Union at that point of time. And only then the Russians said and conveyed to John F. Kennedy that it is only when you remove the Jupiter missiles, we are then going to remove the missiles from Cuba. And the quarantining of the Russian-Soviet Union ships took place. So, you know, that kind of a myth and lore and the storytelling part of the Cold War is very much part of the IR narrative even today. But detente, you talked about. Detente, I would say that it's a kind of a friendship. It's a kind of an internal understanding between countries that they would not cross both the countries like United States of America and Soviet Union at that point of time. They did not cross the threshold, both the threshold of the conventional war and also the threshold of nuclear Armageddon. That Armageddon was realized by both the countries as being a strictly no-no policy, a strictly no-no foreign policy for both the countries. So, you know, in 1971, if you go to 1971, just to sideline Russia, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto arranged for a meet between Henry Kissinger or President Nixon and Mao Zedong. And that happened to place China once again into the mainstream. So what is America shouting about now? Because the United States of America and India, unfortunately, in the 70s, in the 60s, had a role into the mainstreaming of China despite the war or the dark shadow of war which existed, which still sustains a conflictual air between India and China. That is how I would humbly submit to your intervention.
Sir, do you think there would be a new Cold War? If so, then between whom?
I personally feel that a new Cold War already started a couple of years back, or maybe 1.5 years back, wherein China and the United States were involved in a kind of a trade war, and the manner in which they always, both the countries, ran away from a bigger or a comprehensive and a larger than life trade deal between both the countries, and opted for patch up trade solutions or patch up economic solutions. That happened to be a cause of concern, a grievous cause of concern. So, you know, the trade war is generally, one can contend and one can in summation say that trade war is a manifestation of a new Cold War, of a new Cold War. And people were talking about a new Cold War between Russia and United States of America around 3 to 4 years back. And in fact, even my teachers were talking about it, but I was at a divergent position as far as these arguments proffered by my teachers in JNU was concerned, because I personally feel that Vladimir Putin, Prime Minister Modi, Netanyahu, and President Donald Trump, all four of them are going to be the people to go after. Whether we look into the scenario of it, that whether Trump will be able to come back as president in White House or not, that is a different case altogether. But Russia and United States of America have an internal understanding where they will always be together against Turkey, though the equations might be different in Syria, though Russia does not support the Israelis to a great extent, and the lobby of Israel does that, and the Israeli lobby in the United States of America does that. So I personally feel that the new Cold War is already on, has already been on between China and United States of America. But, you know, and this Cold War can only be won when we actually do not compromise with Chinese goods, Chinese manufacturing, and Chinese services. And recently, what we need to realize is that India and China, being under the shadow of a larger conflict, India has been warned by the intelligence agencies in America and in Europe that they have enumerated about 52 Chinese cyber applications which need to be discontinued ASAP, as early as possible, if a further erosion of India's trade secrets and security secrets has to be discontinued at the hands of the mail factory Chinese. I use these strong words because I personally suffered from the 1962 shadows, the kind of maiming of 1,300 casualties which took place in India. Around 1,100 Indian soldiers, Indian martyrs went unrecognized for and uncalled for. And, you know, despite Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru believing in the ideas of Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai, they attacked, and India was not prepared for a war, because we were hoping that despite our forward policy, the Chinese would not go all the way down to a warlike situation or a warlike step. But it was at that point of time, one should not forget that 4 to 6 squadrons of starfighter jets were offered by John F. Kennedy to Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, this being one point. And secondly, radars were also offered for the safety of big Indian urban centers like Mumbai, Kolkata, and Delhi. And so, you know, India and US have always been full of glee for each other. But it is the realistic and a strictly national interest oriented strain of America, and a slightly idealistic strain of foreign policy in India, which has prevented India from joining the bandwagon of United States of America. And unfortunately, the NATO, CATO, and CENTO offers were first of all sent to India. Then it was offered to Pakistan. But Panditji refused, and due to which we still remain as a third world country. That would be my response.
So what about 1971 regarding America's role? America did not help then.
At that point of time, America did not help because, you know, I personally feel that America, I am no soothsayer for United States of America. But at that particular point of time, in 1971, we all remember the negative incident, the pessimistic incident of the gunboat diplomacy when Americans came out with their Abraham Lincoln, USS Abraham Lincoln, maybe to put strategic and maritime pressure on Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. I do agree. But, you know, circumstances change, countries change, and the international scenario has also changed a great deal. Because at that point of time, Pakistan was in the good books of United States of America. And more importantly, Pakistan was being ruled by a democratic Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, and they had a good touch. They had a good understanding. The Pakis had a good understanding with United States of America, despite poor Prime Minister Indira Gandhi doing a world tour of countries to hedge up against the Pakistani ministrations, against the Pakistani antagonism which was being heaped on India. I'm not saying that we become a poodle or we become a lapdog of United States of America. That will never happen. But the ides, the winds and ides of convergence, they are too rampant to be ignored, both by India and United States of America. That would be my response, please.
Thank you, sir. Sir, do you think the neoliberal project whereby the United States wanted to incorporate People's Republic of China into international or more appropriately Western economic organizations, thinking that this would attract China away from communism to a capitalistic liberal democracy, has it failed?
No, I personally feel that America and some of the European countries, they planned the implosion of Soviet Union because it was a communist nation. In the same manner, it is part of the Indian long-drawn strategy, the grand strategy of India and United States of America to make the Chinese implode. Because Chinese have given the virus, according to me, I might be wrong, but that is how Ajit Doval Saab has responded to it. That is how Jai Shankar Saab, the MEA, the minister, has responded to it. That is how the Prime Minister Modi has responded to it. But we have not given a clear-cut answer to China on this account, but we have also not let them free. So, you know, I personally feel I have been writing about it, I have been talking about it, and it is there present as a kind of a common literature on web portals and in the library journals that the futuristic objective of India and America, primarily America, would be the dismemberment of People's Republic of China. And who says there is no capitalism in China? The biggest example of crony capitalism, wherein there is a nexus between the government and the entrepreneurs and both the domestic corporati and the international corporati, that is always there to be seen. So China, for an example, I'll give you an example which is pretty old, but which really strikes me even now in a post-COVID world order, is that Guangdong is a province in China. And in Guangdong, the central government in Beijing, the Communist Party in Beijing, went on and gave literally autonomy to the political leaders in that province when Guangdong promised to give them a lot of money, a lot of taxes, and an astronomical amount of a revenue. So they made Guangdong very free. They made Guangdong very free. And that kind of a capitalistic idea, which is normally crass capitalism, which is associated with United States of America, which was associated with Pramod Mahajanji's Shining India in the first NDA regime, all these things should be looked into. And China happens to be the worst exploiter. The kind of conditions that exist for the workers in China and the kind of forced trains, forced buses that take the Chinese workers from the urban centers to their rural households, they too need to be taken into account if we really want to understand the true economic and strategic tenor of China. I would say they are equally capitalist, but if we come down to the situation in Tibet, the human rights situation in Tibet, the human rights situation in Xinjiang, the Uyghur Turks, the kind of arm twisting that Beijing and the Communist Party does is there to be seen, though we do not come to know much about it because of the effective iron curtain behind which China survives, because that iron curtain saved them to a great extent from the culpability of the Wuhan virus. That would be my humble contention.
Sir, I have one last question for you.
All right.
That is, how much do you think the nuclear weapons of India and China will work as factors of deterrence?
India and China?
Yes, sir.
All right. That would be very nice. It's a very nice question. I think deterrence might work. I'm not saying that we are already sitting atop a fat man or a short boy, which were the name given to the two nukes which fell on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945. We are still not astride that kind of a scenario. But still, if a limited strike, I personally feel that limited strike is an essentiality to vacate the Chinese aggression in the Galwan Valley, in Laptal and in Lipu Lake, where I'll give you an example. If I make a balcony in my house, if I start decorating my house, or if I put a layer of concrete on my rooftop, and if that happens to be an irritant for my neighbor, do I stop the beautification? Do I stop the securitization of my house? That is the question to be answered, because it amounts to a kind of an arm twisting, and it amounts to a kind of a skullduggery by the Chinese. I would come down to your question. Yes, nuclear deterrence is very much there, and India has already agreed to the no first use. And maybe China does not agree to the idea of no first use, wherein India has promised, going by the international nuclear regime, that India will not be the first one to nuke an enemy. It will only respond in a kind of a counter move, in a kind of a retaliatory move, in a defensive move. But India has also started clamoring for scrapping away the NFU, wherein after 2003 and also in the present era, before and during the COVID times, scholars have been talking about it, strategic experts have been talking about it, wherein they have gone on to contend that India can also become the first attacker. We can become the first mover and shaker if a nuclear war is pertinent. I personally realize, as a responsible citizen of this country, that war does not lead to solutions. But when you are being repeatedly poked with a spear, when they don't agree that three of your states are not, they agree, they do not agree with the fact that three of Indian states are not part of India, then a step has to be taken somehow, and enough is enough. But I personally feel that both the countries might come down to ICBMs, but they will not go for a nuclear exchange in any scenario. But others, my friends have told me that China is not known for restraint. China cannot be restrained. But if the Americans threaten them, I'm using very, very stale vocabulary. I'm using something which is very road type, cheapskate words. But still the idea is that if Donald Trump tells them very steadfastly that withdraw from India or do not use a nuclear missile against India, then I think China will hold suit, will pursue suit, because not only America, but Europe and Asia would also be siding with India. And I think it is the sine qua non condition for the rest of the world that we need to unite against China. Unfortunately, even when our domestic situation is slightly shaky and vulnerable. That would be my response.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I would also like to thank all our viewers, and I would also like to ask them to stay connected on Facebook, Instagram, and follow our YouTube channel.